Hi everyone, welcome to the interview with Professor Sergey Ryazantsev from MGIMO University. The interview will be conducted for the Department of International Relations at Istanbul Commerce University. I, Dr. Ayşen Birs Karaçay, will lead the interview for all of us. I hope it will be a good conversation and you will enjoy the whole interview. So at this stage, let me introduce Professor Sergey Ryazantsev for you. He is the head of the Department of Demographic and Migration Policy of the MGIMO University. This is attached to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Russia. At the same time, he is the director of the Institute of Demographic Research. He is the leading Russian specialist in the field of economics, demography and migration. He had lots of projects conducted for ILO, United Nations and with different international organizations, so on and so forth. So I'm really very happy to have Sergey with us. So I have some questions about his project. The project is really very interesting. The title of the project is really very interesting. It's about the feminization of labor migration from Russia to CIS countries, and also he will have the case of Turkey. So I had some brief questions about the feminization of labor migration from Central Asia. Let me start with my question, if everything is okay for you, Sergey. Okay, Sergey. What are the characteristic features of modern migration from Central Asian countries to CIS countries as well as to Turkey? What do you think about it?
Hello, Biris. Nice to meet you in your home university, Istanbul Commercial University. This is my first visit here. Yeah. Thank you for this interview. Trends of labor migration from Central Asia countries very changed, especially last years in pandemic situation. And one of trend is feminization of migration, which start maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And many women emigrated, searched job to Russia, Kazakhstan. And also last year, many Central Asia women also search a job in new destinations as Turkey, United Arab Emirates, and Korea, and something like that. And of course, feminization of migration, very interesting topic for us, for Russian Academy of Science and Department of Migration and Demographic Policy in GIMO University, because it's a new trend. And this trend include more and more people, very influenced for situation in sending and receiving countries.
Okay, so this reminds me of the suitcase trade between Turkey and Russia. I remember after the collapse of the Soviet Union, lots of women migrated to Turkey, but it was not a migration, it was just a suitcase trade for a short period of time. So what is the pattern of the migration coming from the Central Asian women? So they are making a permanent migration, or they are making some sort of suitcase trade with CIS countries, or what do you think about this?
It's not suitcase migration, of course. First of all, this is labor migration, because mostly women emigrated to Russia and Kazakhstan and Turkey, find a job, and majority of them employed in a sector of home economy, and also in services, in trade, in some sectors with cleaning, and majority women orientated for labor market, first of all. Sometime, and our researchers show they accompany husband for labor immigration. On this case, very problem is with whom can stay children. And we have generation of children who lost parents, because parents all time in other countries, and with grandmom or grandfather they sit in, and it's also big problem for Central Asia countries. I don't like to get parallels between this Russian migration in Turkey on the first step of our relation after collapse of Soviet Union, because Central Asia migration more orientated for labor market, of course.
Okay, so what are the consequences of those type of labor migration to Russia and to those Central Asian countries? What are the
consequences? One problem I describe already with kids, but also we have positive and negative consequences, as everywhere. Sending countries like Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and Kyrgyzstan, they has very important role of remittances in playing economy, because Tajikistan is very dependent country from remittances abroad, and women include a lot of contribute a lot of much large percent of this remittances in GDP as well. Secondly, of course, it's just new experience for work, new technology, which exported from Russia or Turkey or from Kazakhstan, labor migrants at home, of course. It's like labor migration consequences, like innovation for Central Asia countries. It's very helpful to develop, of course. But on other hand, we have a negative consequences for sending country like losses of demographic potential, deconstruction, family relations, and emigration of youth. Also, it's problematic consequences of this migration. Russia and Turkey and other CIS countries like Kazakhstan, for example, like a new destination of Central Asia migration, also get more positive consequences, I think, because immigrants include a lot of contribution in economy. They produce a part of GDP of Russia, and our estimation immigrants to produce now around 8% of Russian GDP in different sectors of economy. And women contributions, of course, very important as well, because if Central Asia women to work at family, Russian women can go to labor market, can go to be more free, and it's also plus for Russian economy, it's my opinion.
This is also interesting, because if I think about the case of Turkey, I can say that most of the migrants coming from Central Asia may work in informal markets, so there isn't any formal market for them. So is it the case for the Russia as well? Because you have already told about the contribution of the Central Asian woman, but for our case, as far as I know from very few research about Central Asia, they are mostly working at the informal sectors.
Informal what are sector. In Russia also we fixed this problem, of course, but officials, government to try change immigration law and to do immigration flow more open, more for statistic, for everything. And of course, we have some part of informal labor market which accept a lot of migrants as well. Mostly they are concentrated in construction sphere, in sector of services, but when start lockdown in Russia, a lot of migrants not leave Russia. They stay in Russia because they are understand it's very difficult to go at home, not only for travel problem, but first problem was money problem, because people go to Russia and want to work. First of all, because they supposed them family and households at home. And many migrants in Russia, and include women, were very adaptive they are stay in lockdown and change a place of work. For example, when close a construction objects, migrants went to delivery sector or mm-hmm. taxi service or trade service, mostly delivery very grow up in lockdown situation. And of course, migrants from Central Asia, mostly they contribute more for Russian economy, I think. And mm-hmm. specific of the Russia Federation is our migration law is very problematic with registration, you know.
Yeah.
And registration mm-hmm. system is very archaic and very basic on Soviet time mm-hmm. principle, and many experts says about need to change this situation because our informal labor market more provoked from this Soviet system of registration. I think if we change this system, our informality will be not so large like now.
Now, yeah, okay. So again, it reminds me the Asian countries, this labor migration flow. You say that there's a huge labor migration coming from Central Asian countries to Russia and to other countries like Turkey. So I know that most of the Asian countries are supporting this type of migration flows to get those type of remittances. For example, they are supporting migration to Middle East countries mm-hmm. so that they can have some sort of remittance. So is there any support coming from the Central Asian governments to those, you know, labor migrants, or is there any type of policy conducted by in those governments, Central Asian governments?
They are start to develop some programs which orientated for more effective using of these remittances flow. Central Asia government. Mm-hmm. For example, Uzbekistan changed very much system last 2-3 years ago when change a government, change a new president. Mm-hmm. Now in Mirziyoyev, president is a very open economy, very give a privilege for every investments from abroad, and also opinion of officials in Uzbekistan for labor immigrants from Uzbekistan very change, because before that previous president he called migrants like not very good people who mm-hmm. leave country and work abroad and not construct economy at home. Now situation absolutely change. And for example, Uzbekistan, I think it's maybe very important case because Uzbekistan very large country, you know, and majority migrants, this is first place in Russia for quantity of migrant, labor mm-hmm. migrant. Mm-hmm. 4 million migrants from Uzbekistan every year to emigrated mostly in Russia and Kazakhstan and some part in Turkey as well. Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan also change policy. Kyrgyzstan more orientated for cooperation with international organizations mm-hmm. like UNDP and other United Nations system. Tajikistan is more slow in this case, but general problem is for using remittances, very high level of taxes, immigrants mostly to invest money in first option, this is food, clothes, more and more migrants invest in education. This mm-hmm. is good because it's an investment in social capital. But generally, United Nations recommended all Central Asia countries to develop more instrument for develop regime of invest this money without taxes, for example, in social programs or in transport infrastructure system, because some households or migrants, they are ready to help local places, for local authorities, for example, change water supply system or something, or transportation or school, for example. And we got this example and I visited Tajikistan, for example, and saw it when people help motherland to change something life in the land, for example, to construct a school or a road or something like that. Mm-hmm. But countries in Central Asia need to think more about situation when these remittances will finish, because mm-hmm. it's very limited source as well.
It's a limited source, okay. So this reminds me again another question, especially for the case of pandemic conditions. So during the COVID-19 era, it's really very difficult to go from one place to another place, and even from one country to another country. So, and you already say that there is a huge labor migration coming from the CIS countries, and you also told us that there are some changing strategies created by the migrants. So they are shifting their, you know, sectors, as far as I understand. So are there any case of human smuggling or human trafficking? Because since mm-hmm. borders are closed, since everything is locked down, so do you think that there's an increase in the smuggling or also trafficking issues, cases? Or
we not especially to research this problem, but I know about growing up cases of violence from for example, different type of violence. First of all, violence from police who got checking in some migration places, and very often in lockdown pandemic, police said about problems like try to connect migrants with terrorism or something like that. Uh-huh. That's one problem. Second problem is, of course, in this pandemic situation, migrants who stay and depend from employers, like in small houses, hostels, or something, or in construction mm-hmm. object, they are very depend from employees because couldn't change place of work and place of live. And we have some cases where people lost a passport because employees take a passports and keep people mm-hmm. like a workforce. And also sort type of violence it in family violence, because people sit at home in lockdown and going up cases of violence inside family, include migration family as well, because if people sit at home or apartment long time together, people couldn't start to have problems in family, inside family. It's it's reality as well.
Yeah, okay. And then the case of Russia, the Russian society, if you look at the case of Europe, you will see that there's a highly growing populist, you know, policies, mm-hmm. so Hungary and so on and so forth. So what is the Russian society's perspective towards the migrants, labor migrants coming from Central Asia? Are they, you know, accepting those type of migration flows, or are they a little bit against to those flows?
It's very depend from region, very depend from situation, from local people, from history. Mm-hmm. Russia is very big, you know, big country with many, many specific places, and it's depend from political situation. For example, some regions accept a lot of migrants. Some politicians every time to try to get a populism and try to again start migrantophobia discourse, because it's very actively before some political issues like election or something like that, and it's very depend also. For example, I visited not so long time ago in Tatarstan. This is Muslim region in Russia, Republic of Tatarstan. It's very accept migrant from Central Asia because they are same with religion, situation. Moscow is also very depend from part of Moscow, because also some districts is more loyalty, some district more aggressive. I think for Russian society, it's very important to develop national program of integration, national integration plan, for example, or program, because now we have now this integration policy, we have a migration concept until 2025. We have, of course, structures who realize this problem in MVD, Ministry of Internal Affairs. But my opinion, we need to more develop integration part of migration policy of Russia now. For
the Russian policy making of migration, do you think that the Russian government is taking some sort of consultancy from the universities, from the civil society organization, or they are making just their own migration policy? Are there some sort of, you know, let's say, working together?
They try, and we try to help them, of course, because now migration policy more concentrated, as I said before, in main directorate of migration in Ministry of Internal Affairs, and they organize a special public committee, which include scientists, NGO leaders, and representative of some diaspora of migrants, and they try to organize meeting regularity. For example, one time 3 months or three, 4 months is good. It's good possibility to have discussion and discuss about important change of law, for example, citizenship or regulation of labor migration. But I think maybe for Russia very important to have a special structure which will do migration policy, not like force structure. It's need more orientated for development, because migration is develop, help for develop of country. And my opinion must be migration service or service of migration and integration or naturalization, which can accumulate this sphere in inside work. And I think it's Russia has had this experience, because we have Federal Migration Service until 2016. But after that, this service was cancelled, and this sphere was consolidated in Ministry of Internal Affairs. I think now is good possibility to construct new structure, which will be separate from Ministry of Internal Affairs, because Ministry of Internal Affairs, this is more structure who must to prevention criminality. But migration is not criminality. Migration, this is develop of country, of course.
It helps to development, of course. So my final question will be about the case of Turkey. So as far as I know from my research, there were some sort of laws coming from Russia to Turkey, and it have already changed from suitcase trade to an intermarriage migration. Do you think that there will be further migration coming from Russia as well as from Central Asian countries? Do you have such a view, or what do you think about that?
I think Turkey is very, very interesting destination for Russian migration and Central Asian migration as well. And maybe I hope we will have maybe in close future renaissance of Russian Turkish migration when COVID will
be finished.
because Russia now is very developed and we need a lot of constructed workers. And you remember your previous experience about your dissertation about construction companies from Turkey in Russia. I think we need Turkish construction company again, because Russia is developed, many building now is constructed, and I hope it can be a new time for this migration, first of all. Also, Russians very like Turkey, like a place for investment, money for apartments or for resort, and I think also it's if will be develop our political relations, we can have this bridge between Russia and Turkey as well. On same time, Central Asia very depend from Russia, and if Russia will be developed with Turkey, I think Central Asia migrants also will go to Turkey
as well.
It's my forecast for close future.
Yeah. Okay. Sergey, thank you for all your answers and for your all interpretations. Hope we will meet again to discuss the results of your project and have a great and fruitful time for your project. Okay.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. I hope so for develop our cooperation as well. Thank you very much.
Sure.